Hi, I'm Peter Freedman, owner of RØDE Microphones and Event Electronics. I've spent all my life in the music business, starting when I worked in my dad's sound company in the early 70s in Sydney. I want to share with you how it now feels to meet and call so many of the legends of the music industry friends of mine. This is like a dream, and to have my RØDE and Event products used worldwide by these people is truly the pinnacle of my career. When I was a teenager, my friends and I used all the money we could get on records like Floyd's Dark Side of the Moon and, of course, the Alan Parsons Project. It is now my great pleasure to introduce Alan Parsons, one of the world's most influential music industry leaders. It's a real honour to be talking to you today. Thank you. You inspired me when I started in the industry. You opened my ears to what could be achieved, and I thank you for that.
Thank you.
I'd like to talk to you about the beginning of your career. I mean, you were 19, I believe. Went to Abbey Road, got a job at Abbey Road. How did you get the job?
I'd actually been working for EMI in a West London factory facility where they were making reel-to-reel records on quarter-inch tape. It was just before the advent of cassettes, which was the, as we all know, the worst format of all time. But it was a department that was closely allied to Abbey Road. And as a result of that, I got to hear all the latest and the most recent products coming out of there. And one of them was Sgt Pepper. And I just, at that point, said, I need to get a job at Abbey Road. I need to figure out how they're doing all this stuff. So that's how it all started.
Yeah, inspiration for many, Sgt Peppers, certainly. I mean, as we said, Beatles were inspirational. I'm sure you agree, we can trace a lot of the modern recording techniques back to that era, and to George Martin and Jeff Emerick and those sort of people. What was it like working with them? You were involved in quite a few projects, I believe, there, as well as Let It Be.
Yeah, the first Beatles thing I was involved with was the original sessions for Let It Be, the live sessions. Words of wisdom, let it be. 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 And that was actually at the Beatles' own studio, the Apple building in Savile Row in London. But those sessions did include the rooftop session, so I was there for that. That was fun.
One, two, three, four.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that because I've seen it so many times. What was it like being there? Were you running some of the equipment, or were you helping set up the studio part?
Yeah, I mean, although it was meant to be the Beatles' own studio, nothing worked.
Right. So, it was at Apple headquarters, wasn't it?
Yeah. So Abbey Road got brought in to make sure that everything did work. Mm. And I was there to tape up and run mic lines from the control room in the basement up to the rooftop and things like that. Right. And I was there on the roof For the duration of the concerts.
Right. So Dark Side of the Moon is without doubt one of the greatest recordings of all time, and it certainly sets standards, new standards for audio. Breathe in the air. Don't be afraid to care. I mean, I know everybody would approach, you'd approach every project to try and the best that you can do, but did you say, I'm going to change something, I'm going to make this something really special, new techniques?
I didn't consciously look towards doing anything radically different to what I'd do on anybody else's record, but it has to be said, I was quite new to the game then. Mm. I mean, I hadn't really done that much engineering work, at least not for a big band like Pink Floyd. So it was quite a moment for me to get the job.
Yeah.
And so I obviously did my best. I obviously tried to impress them with whatever I could. But we did make a good team. I mean, there's no question.
But to me, it was like amazing dynamic range, things I'd never heard before, and maybe the textures as well in the music. I mean, you were involved in some of the production of that as well.
Not technically, no. I was totally an engineer. If I'd produced Dark Side of the Moon, we'd be doing this interview on my yacht in the Caribbean.
I thought we were. A lot of studio techniques were creeping into live. They were obviously trying to get it to sound reasonable.
Yeah, well, you know, the Floyd knew their sound was important, and they, generally speaking, have always used studio guys to do their live mixing.
A lot of tape as well running during the show.
For effects, yeah. We would bring in the clock effects and the
Reboxes.
The money loop and stuff. It was actually a TIAC 4-track.
Okay.
Because we had to do it in quadraphonic.
So I remember seeing 10cc years ago and all the Reboxes were running. I think, wow, if something went wrong with that, what would you do?
Yeah, it would have been tough.
So you also work with the Hollies, and they're an amazing band. And I remember my father used to, we had a PA company in Sydney. And he actually mixed them when they came to Sydney in the late 60s, and I actually met some of the guys in the band.
Oh.
Yeah, it was very, very cool. But can you tell me a little bit about working with them?
They were one of the first acts that I got associated with as a tape op. Mm. So their main engineer at the time that I started was a guy called Peter Bowne. He did most of their hits. And There was never a nicer bunch of guys to work with than the Hollies. They were so, you know, just so friendly and unaffected. Yeah, absolutely. And they were lovely to work with. And they always arrived on time. They never worked late. You know, it was
good
just
to be with them.
Yeah, they were great.
Professional.
And it taught me a lot about song choice because Ron Richards, who had produced all their hits, he just knew a hit song when he heard it. And never more so than with He Ain't Heavy and The Air That I Breathe. He just said, those are hit songs, we've got to do that.
A special gift, eh? Yeah. Absolutely. So let's talk about the projects. I mean, these are very special to me and most of people my generation for many reasons. And again, I think you set new standards for sound quality obviously I'm not a musician, but I can see the textures and the light and the dark and music and the dynamic range change, which was so exciting to listen to. I think you also, in that time, for me, you defined the concept album. That's how I feel. Maybe I'm not educated enough, but certainly a lot of my friends and a lot of people I respect share that as well. So how did you and Eric Wolfson get together, and what motivated you both?
I met Eric in Abbey Road Studios. He was producing a sort of child prodigy, you know, a star in the making from one of those TV talent shows. And he knew of my work with Pink Floyd, and he knew that I just had a hit with Pilot with a song called Magic, which did quite well around the world. Oh, ho, ho, it's magic, you know. Never believe it's that song. It's magic. And he decided that I needed a manager, and offered himself as manager. And then within a few short weeks, we were talking about making the first project album, which was the Edgar Allan Poe based Tales of Mystery and Imagination. And
I remember it well.
He was, you know, he was a songwriter as well as a very good businessman. Mm. So we went to meet him and did a deal for the record, and before 6 months were up, we were in the studio making it.
So how does it feel to be part of pop culture? I mean, you talked about in movies like Austin Powers. I've even seen stuff on The Simpsons. You know, my kids know about you.
It was invented by the noted Cambridge physicist, Dr. Parsons. Therefore, we shall call it the Alan Parsons Project.
Oh, my God.
What now?
The Alan Parsons Project is a progressive rock band in 1982.
Grand Funk Railroad paved the way for Jefferson Airplane, which cleared the way for Jefferson Starship. The stage was now set for the Alan Parsons Project, which I believe was some sort of hovercraft.
Dad, no one cares about any of your stupid dinosaur bands. You have the worst, lamest taste in music ever.
What's that feel like?
Oh, it's wonderful. I mean, the latest thing, which I was particularly proud of, was the fact that Sirius, which is the opening bars of Eye in the Sky, were used for the Super Bowl game this year.
That's right, yeah. Yeah, there you go. I mean, it's a rule, you want to sort of run out and do something when you hear it. It's really cool.
Yeah, you want to run out to the record company and say, where's my money?
Where's my money? Yeah, well done. So I've heard you've been described as a recording director rather than an engineer. Can you explain that to me?
It's just that I think the role of a record producer is much more akin to the role of a film director.
Right.
You're saying, you know, you know this is where you should come in with this part. Much more directorial as opposed to the film producer, who is a guy that sits behind the desk and counts the money. You know. Mm. So I always, you know, thought that I was more of a Steven Spielberg than I was a Broccoli Brothers, you know,
yeah,
kind
right.
of character.
Absolutely.
So not that I'm comparing myself to Spielberg, you know, what a genius, but just the role of, you know, essentially being in charge,
sure.
and arranging. Being part of the arrangement, making sure the performance is right, just, you know, deciding when the song is finished.
Mm. But you're a musician and you obviously love the process. That's why you'd have to do it anyway. It's not just
I'm a musician of sorts. I'm no virtuoso. Mm. I get by as a musician. I think the fact that I can speak musicians' language is important, but but beyond that, you know, there's a lot of great producers that aren't musicians.
Yeah,
they just have a feel for it. I mean, we just talked about him, Ron Richards, the Hollies producer. He was not a musician,
right? But he had a feel.
But
for
he
music.
Had a great ear, fantastic ear.
Yeah, I think all the great people that I've met who are live sound or studio, the best ones, they are. If they're not musicians, but they understand it, they totally get it, they know what the music instrument should sound like. Otherwise, how could you mix? How can you mix if you don't understand music? The recording industry has gone through some amazing changes, certainly in the last couple of decades, and obviously the digital revolution. What do you see as the good and the bad with digital? I mean, that's a big question. But
I think the ability to cut and paste is a magical thing. Without a razor blade. I mean, I was just, for instance, yesterday mixing a live track, and the keyboard player fluffed just one repetitive riff. So we just literally took the next time the riff came, you know, and replaced it onto the time before, and that, it was done. It was done in 10 seconds. Whereas to try to achieve that in analog days would have been a nightmare, unless the whole section would have been repeated by everybody, in which case it would have been possible, but it still would have taken some time copying and then going down a generation in order to reinsert something. I like the cut and paste aspects, the non-linear aspects of DAW recording, but I was in there right at the beginning with digital tape machines. But even, you know, digital tape machines were still essentially a linear format. So I just applied the same rules to digital, but the nice thing was you could go through just several generations of copying without losing anything. So that was good. But there was a certain magic to tape and the way things were with tube electronics. It had a certain magic, which for the most part has been lost now. But hey, the advantages I think outweigh the disadvantages of digital recording.
So you still think analog to you sounds better? Traditional old analog other than the noise?
I think I've arguably done my best work on analog.
Right. You know?
But I don't think I'd be the one to say I think analog sounds better. Mm-hmm. I'd just say some of my best work has been done in the analog domain. Mm.
Do you think people tried harder before and were working more on engineering techniques? Because I mean, just my own observation, because of all this amazing technology, people don't spend a lot of time setting up microphones or getting an acoustic treatment right and really getting the sound great acoustically. They've got all the trickery and they just not throw it up, but they work on that. They sort of lean on that a little bit more. The engineering seems to have gone. Do you think that's true?
Well, that's all you had. I mean, you had to balance with mic technique and what few tracks you had. I mean, when I came into the business, we were recording four tracks, and that was a real challenge to get the engineering right. You know, nowadays you have the ability to record on as many tracks as you need,
unlimited,
and the art of creating a balance that's going to work for the record, you know, right from the word go. That took a certain skill.
Yeah.
And that skill has kind of been washed away by the technology.
Yeah, everybody should be given a two-track machine and some mics to go, now pull a sound. And if you can do that, you're allowed to have a couple more tracks.
That's right.
Yeah. I mean, when you went to Abbey Road, were they still doing there was the set positions for mics? I've read that in some, I remember Jeff Emmerich talking about that, and they got into trouble they could have got fired by moving the mic closer to get...
There was a sort of decree, you know, that went out from the management on the staff notice board. You know, ribbon microphones will not be used on kick drum.
Yeah, right.
and that was a sort of management directive. I think every engineer had his style. And Jeff, in particular, had a style. And I was, so privileged to work with some of these great engineers. I mean, Jeff Emmerich, Ken Scott, Peter Baum, Peter Vince, and also the classical engineers. I mean, all the classical engineers who were also doing fantastic work at the time that I came into the industry.
What about MP3? What do you think?
It sucks.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, it's horrible. I mean, the encouraging thing is that, compressed audio probably will improve over the years. Mm. And we'll be less fussy about how much disk space or memory space we use up for music, because drives are getting bigger and cheaper. I've just seen a little USB stick drive with 256 gig of capacity. I mean, that's just unbelievable. Mm. That's as much as capacity as I've ever needed on a computer at any one time.
It's incredible, man.
I mean, it's unbelievable. So it needs to improve. I mean, if we're going to download music forever, which it seems we are, it must get better, because it's just not a good sounding format yet.
I love good sound quality. Obviously, with the event project that I'm. The Opals, it has been an amazing thing, and I love sitting listening to critical recordings, etc. But most people just want some background music and put their earbuds.
Yeah, I think times have changed on how people perceive what music is. I mean, when I was in the record buying consumer public, I would bring home my shiny new vinyl album and dim the lights and put it on, play it start to finish without interruption.
Mm. On your Linn Sondek,
and get up and cleaning. Turn it over.
Yeah.
No, I never did have a Linn Sondek. I knew.
I borrowed.
I knew Ivor Tiefenbrunn quite well. But,
okay.
But He decided never to give me one.
Okay.
With his turntable.
I had to buy one.
There's always been this slightly, quite a wide dividing line between the hi-fi community and the pro audio community.
Sure.
And what's important to a hi-fi nut is not in the least important to a pro audio person, for example. I mean, I know your products are aimed at firmly at pro audio rather than consumer people, but sometimes you're lucky. Sometimes a product will cross over from consumer into pro audio or vice versa. But generally speaking, they're diametrically opposed.
Mm. But it is education, and you know, talking about the speaker thing, what I love now, there's nothing more exciting to take somebody who's never heard good sound, and I sit them in front of the Apples and I say, bring your music, and we play it, and you see their face, they haven't heard things. They've listened to these tracks hundreds of times, and for the first time they're hearing parts of the music. And it's just a smile on my face, I've got to have this, this is incredible. Slowly people will start doing that. But do you mix for the best you can do, obviously, I'd imagine, but you still have to have it work with MP3. Do you have to change anything when you think like that or not?
I certainly listen on headphones,
right?
Because, a fair proportion of the people that are going to hear music are going to hear it on, you know, little white earbuds.
Yeah.
And, but I don't think I've ever consciously compromised.
No.
For the sake of an MP3 listener or an iPod listener. Mm-hmm. One sort of side note about the MP3 and iPod issue is that, you know, if people are putting music from CD into their iPods, so many of them are converting them to MP3 first, and that's the ultimate sin, I think. Mm. People should not do
it's
that.
It's not necessary, too, yeah. It's plenty of storage in
plenty
the
of
iPod.
Storage, yeah.
Do you record using microphones that capture the ambience, or do you mix to 5.1 or a combination?
Generally speaking, I don't think about 5.1 until the mix.
Right.
There have been times when I went out and recorded some sound effects on a sound field mic, you know, for a previous album, and there are some great effects recordings out
there.
But generally, you know, I've just literally mixed for 5.1 rather than recorded for 5.1. Interestingly, I mean, if we backtrack for a moment, Dark Side of the Moon was recorded right at the time when quadraphonic first started.
Mm.
And we did Bear It in Mind. And so all the sound effects for Dark Side were recorded on four tracks.
And so was a quadraphonic mic?
No, just recorded in such a way that we knew it would work in quadraphonic.
Because I've got a really cool, I found this, I think about 12 of them made, Neumann made a quadraphonic mic. They weren't very successful, but you can actually now use that to do like the sound fill with the processing. Mm-hmm. It's fantastic fun. And of course, RNT4.
Are you going to make one?
Yeah, we will. It's an esoteric area, and of course you need to be an educated person, but why not? You know, it's just about getting the capsule super closely matched. And then making it a variable, but all the post-processing, not a problem. It's just another
Have you noticed
tool.
How I've managed to turn the interview into me talking to Peter?
Well, it's making it easier for me. Certainly making it easier. Do you record in stereo in a session, like stereo XY mics?
If I'm doing orchestra, I'll think about XY. We've got an XY up here.
NT4.
All right. I'm more likely to use spaced mics than coincident mics. I've been known to hang a pair up, above an orchestra, just as an ambient pair.
Right.
Just for my own taste and for my own records, I prefer spot mics.
Right.
Generally speaking.
Like a bloom line thing as well.
Not particularly. I've done some MS miking.
Right.
In fact, when we get into this, I'll talk about it. Just recently recorded a choir for the program I've been working on, and we got a fantastic result with MS miking.
Mm-hmm.
Really superb stereo spread.
So, what are you working on?
Well, it's an entire series. It's about 9 hours of video altogether. It's going to be a series called The Art and Science of Sound Recording, and it's essentially a tutorial aimed at musicians and people coming into the industry. It's a documentary program, of course, and educational. But what makes it, I think, interesting against some of the other competition that's out there is that I've included interviews, like me talking to you, with lots of other engineers, producers, artists, and so on. So we've got a really good general view on each stage of the recording process from a lot of people, and I think that's going to really sort it out against some of the competition. So we're already online with it, and planning to release July at the very latest.
And it is aimed at what, the entry level up to more professional?
It's a lot of pros have seen it and said, well, I still learnt something from this program, so
sure.
Which is great. And I didn't want it to be totally a teacher to a child sort of.
Sure.
I wanted to appeal to all levels of people in recording, really.
Mm. Just a little bit about gear again. If what are the critical things for you? What, like, you must have the finest in a certain area, or positional, or whether it's monitors, mic. What do you look for? What are you?
I think the speakers are the most important thing in the chain, really.
Okay.
I mean, if you're not getting a proper impression through the monitoring system, how can you possibly make any judgments? So you have to know your speakers.
Mm.
And the nice thing about the way speaker design has gone is that they are getting smaller. Mm. And I mean, never more obvious than your yeah, Opals, which are yeah. very compact. And of course, they sound much bigger than any speaker that size would have ever sounded 20
years ago.
That was
the quest, because people were saying, more monitors, but I can't get the bottom end. So we thought, all right, this is one of the things, other than the incredible clarity, we have to nail, which we did. But so near fields, that's, you don't use main monitors anymore, just to impress the client?
I use both. I've especially because I have a 5.1 system. I think it's important to have good main monitors as well. But I've had event speakers in my room for many years now. And Francis Buckley first turned me onto them.
That's right. Yeah, he's still with us. He's a good man, a good engineer as well, good endorsee. So if you were advising somebody starting out, what would you say, what should they do? What should they get? Not brand-wise, but just equipment, just the most cost-effective.
Just to echo what I just said, leave some money for the speakers,
because
that's really the most important thing. What you hear is what is going to determine what your audience hears.
Sure.
So that's very important. Good mics too. Good songs, that's important.
Yeah, always work with the best, makes you look good.
Wow, there you go.
Yeah, and to that end, Alan Parsons, thank you so much for your time.
Most welcome, thank you.
I would like to thank Alan for his time today and for sharing so many valuable insights into the industry that we all love. I hope that you look forward to the next interview with a legend as much as I do.